Fermi la bouche.
What does that mean?
Fermi la bouche means shut your mouth.
In what?
French.
Huh.
If you would just fermi your fucking bouche for a minute.
It is Frightday. This is episode 42. I'm your host, Byron. And tonight, the necrosis nightmare continues as we review Contracted Phase 2. And Kelly finally admits that there is no such thing as extraterrestrial life.
No, wait. No. That's not the case.
In this week's edition of Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies, I'm joined tonight by Kelly.
Hi there.
And Sam.
Hey, guys.
So you guys were late today.
Yeah. You know what I was talking to Sam about? The only two times we've ever been late are the only two times you've ever been on time.
It's very true. I'm usually about 45 minutes late.
Right. But I just need to learn. If I'm going to be late, you're going to be on time. Always.
No. So I slowly walked up to your door, even though the lights were down low. I was like, maybe they're just upstairs. I knock. Duck, duck, duck. Really slow. I hear your dogs a little bit on the inside, but not like going crazy. So I put my head up against the glass in the side of your window.
Oh, bad idea.
Your massive dog hits the window and barks so loud in my face, exactly like a horror film. I felt like a teenage boy snooping around someone's yard I shouldn't be.
Buster's a little rough on the stranger danger.
I didn't like it. I see why they use this trope a lot, because it's very unsettling and shocking.
Just slavering, snarling.
Poor B.
I fully embrace it now. It works.
Oh, good.
I'm sorry about that, man.
Hey, that's okay. I had time to watch videos in my car. I'm not going to talk about it.
Okay, I was just
okay.
Kidding.
Now, Kelly doesn't like it when I talk about the stuff I watch.
Nope, I don't.
Unless I'm talking about horror films that I watched this week.
What'd you watch?
Shocker? Are you familiar?
Yes, no. I am familiar, but I have not seen that one since I was a kid.
Yeah, so Shocker is a very 1989 film directed by Wes Craven. Rest in peace.
Oh, Crave.
Yeah. Stars Michael Murphy, Peter Berg, and Mitch Pileggi himself. Skinner from X-Files. While writing the synopsis myself, I was digging through the official synopsis. And since this movie's so wild, and I like this summary so much, I'm just going to read it, okay?
Go.
This is going to be a treat. A murderous TV repairman, Horace Pinker, which is a great name for a serial killer.
You're destined to kill somebody.
he's killing people in a small town, left, right, and center. He eventually finds the home of Lieutenant Parker, who is investigating his crimes, and savagely murders Parker's wife, son, and daughter.
Wow.
His other son, Jonathan, has a strange connection to Pinker, get this, through his dreams. And he directs his father to Pinker's business, where a small group of officers enter. Pinker escapes in a horrific spree, killing four of the officers, and then targeting Jonathan's girlfriend, Allison. Another dream leads Jonathan and his dad to the residence, where they catch Pinker in the act of kidnapping. Pinker is arrested, and this is still just the beginning of the movie. I'm not spoiling anything. Pinker is arrested after the fight with Jonathan. He's sentenced to die in the electric chair. When electrocuted, Pinker, who supposedly had given his soul to the devil in exchange for the power to come back as an energy source, takes over people's bodies and continues committing murders until Jonathan figures some shit out. I'm just going to stop here. That's a movie.
Huh.
That Wes Craven made. Basically, in an attempt to start a new franchise, it didn't work out.
For you, where does this fall in the canon of Wes Craven?
It's so tough, because it's definitely in my top 13 Wes Craven films.
Wow.
It's definitely on the tail end of the list.
Compared to The Hills Have Eyes 2.
How many movies did Wes Craven make? Anyone?
I don't know.
Don't ask questions. We have to know the answers.
Well, I was just wondering. I was trying to put this in context of like his top 13.
He hasn't made probably more than 30.
Sure, that sounds like a good number to me.
Someone could look it up. Yeah. I never finished The Hills Have Eyes 2. That was too hard to finish. So this is definitely above that. I don't know why it has to do with dreams again. That was kind of an odd choice. Wicked soundtrack. the third act goes completely off the rails, then onto another rail, and then off of that rail.
Just rail hopping?
It hops rails, and it definitely falls apart in the third act. It's pretty fun at the beginning, and I definitely recommend everyone watches it. I know they just reissued it on Blu-ray as well, some sort of collector's edition.
So if it's in your top 13, it's better than the top half.
Sure.
29.
There we go. That makes
directed
sense.
Directed by Wes Craven.
But I haven't seen probably a huge portion of the latest Wes Craven films. What is it? Soul to Take? Is that?
Oh, yes. Yeah. That was kind of meh.
Okay, you're shaking your head. We can't talk. I know it's been a couple weeks.
Let's not
I feel
talk
like
about.
We're kind of tearing into old Wes. But
no.
The things he did right, he did better than anyone else. And I very much appreciate that. Shocker is a fun fucking movie. Watch it. I've also been really into Mythbusters lately.
What myths have you been watching busted?
We don't need to talk about that. It's just better than the serial killer confessions that I've been sleeping to.
Yeah, that's why I like listening to you talk about Mythbusters.
Byron.
I'm also out of airplane disaster documentaries.
God, Byron.
Well, there's only so much footage of crashing planes.
Wait, no. I did watch a documentary on the Hindenburg.
Jesus.
What did you watch?
I don't know if I've ever mentioned how much I enjoy a good anthology. In particular, anthology films from the 80s.
So, like Creepshow?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, along those
perfect
lines.
Perfect example.
Okay.
I watched a movie called Scream Time that falls right into that wheelhouse. Made in 1983, released in 1986.
Oh, okay.
And I don't even know what to say about it. It wasn't even bad. It was just so terrible that it was past bad and didn't come back around to good. Three segments with a wraparound that was the most insanely incoherent garbage that I've ever seen committed to film.
Was it more coherent than VHS Viral?
No, it was not.
Wow.
It starts off in New York, 42nd Street in the 80s, like super gritty porno theaters everywhere.
Real grimy.
Yeah, and there are these two kind of goon type New York guys who, during the credits, walk into a video store, kind of smash and grab a whole stack of videotapes, and then run out, escape into the subway, and go to some female acquaintance's house who is taking a shower. She's got to go on a date, but first, hey, well, let's just watch a few movies, and then you can go on your date. So they all sit down, watch
a few movies?
Yeah, exactly.
Multiple videotapes.
Yeah, exactly. It makes no sense. Sit down on this terrible couch in this very obvious, not even a soundstage, it's just like a stock room on some shitty porno studio.
Yeah, okay.
Then proceed to watch these three movies. They're worse than the wraparound. The first one, are you guys familiar with Punch and Judy, the puppets?
No.
When you see like the English puppets, they've been around since like
the puppets,
1400s.
Man.
I totally agree.
No. Oh, I know exactly
like
what you're talking about.
It's like the
one
guy
now.
With the big nose. Yeah, exactly. The
I know exactly what you're talking about. Yeah.
No, dude.
Yeah,
no.
So there's this elderly gentleman who has as a passion his Punch and Judy show. And his family hates him for it.
I hate
understandably.
Him for it. Yeah,
I would have fucking smothered him in his sleep well before they made a movie about it. They make him choose between the puppets and them because they're moving to Canada. And if he doesn't burn his puppet show and move with them to Canada, then I guess he stays with his puppets and they go to Canada. Oh, did I mention that we're in England now also?
Bounce from New York
yes.
to England.
We're in England.
And well, they're watching movies, so it really could take place wherever. I mean, that's okay.
Yeah,
so
all three.
Is the wraparound about watching the movies?
The movies.
Okay.
Basically.
I get it.
Kind of.
Okay.
So the son, who hates his father for being a weirdo puppeteer,
yeah.
burns the puppet show, and that's enough to push the old man over the edge. And then the puppets start murdering all these people who hate puppets in his life, his wife and his son and his son's girlfriend. But really, it's just him with a puppet on his hand, holding a 2x4 and beating people to death with it.
Holding a 2x4, huh?
Yeah.
Like, I would with love the to puppet. See what he thinks the puppet's doing versus him just like brutally hitting someone with a 2x4. Is that?
That's one thing they kind of almost did right. Initially, you just see a puppet beating someone with the 2x4.
Sure.
You're left to believe, well, maybe the puppet's animated, but it's not.
They pull back.
Just the old guy, yeah. And he ends up getting dumped into a trash compactor, and that's the end of it.
I actually do kind of like that approach.
Is it?
Oh, no.
So then we're back in the apartment, and there's some more inane banter. They eat food. Like, there's food in the refrigerator. We don't know what it is. It's like everything about this movie, you can't even tell what it is. It's just like food.
Sounds like a bad first date.
Terrible. And the next segment is, it's total dog shit. It's called Dream House.
Sure. I'm looking at that right now.
So. Yeah.
Oh, that was a good movie with Daniel Craig.
Nope. This is not that one.
Well, I don't know that it was good.
This couple moves into a house, and promptly after, the woman starts having these creepy visions of horribly disfigured people, you know, on the property. Everyone thinks she's crazy.
Like zombies?
No, we don't know. They're just all just glorified.
Well, because zombies people. Are glorified and disfigured.
I like glorified. That's fun.
I pulled that out of the death metal
You okay?
Thesaurus.
You're fine?
Mini stroke.
Okay, we're going to get through this.
And no one else can see. Her husband can't see these bloody, grim people. Mm-hmm. So obviously, he thinks that she's crazy. To prove him wrong, she gets a medium in, and the medium still says, no, there are no ghosts here. You're crazy.
So they called a large. It was a size joke.
That was a good joke.
Not polite.
Thanks.
Good joke.
Okay.
So they're left with nothing to do but move out. And it turns out that what really happened, these people she was seeing, they were premonitions of the family that would move in after they moved out, who were then all murdered by an escaped killer.
Oh, no. My head. Okay. So,
actually, hey, I had to watch that. That's this thing. That's kind of a cool idea.
So, wait, they're seeing premonitions of the future. Does
she
that mean
wasn't
in the future?
Seeing ghosts. She was seeing what was going to happen in the future.
She was like a psychic.
She's the large.
That's why the medium didn't see any ghosts, because there were no ghosts. She was just projecting. Stupid.
Yeah, but does that mean that she's going to die first in the house? Maybe she's already dead, or...
You know, I think Back to the Future did a better job dealing with the kind of temporal displacement and paradox issues.
Okay.
I think.
And what about that Twin Pines Mall?
Back to the Future?
Yeah, that has a lot to do with predicting 9/11.
Does it really?
Yeah. Did you know that on the clock, it's 1:16, and you turn that upside down, and it's 9/11.
Holy shit.
Throughout the whole movie, the clock tower says 9/11, and it strikes, and the Islamic terrorists come in, shoot Doc Brown at the beginning. And then I'm getting so...
Byron, you need to stop listening to 9/11 conspiracy theorists.
I'll do my best.
I even find them to be insane.
But look what you did to me. I was a normal person when this podcast started.
I didn't do that to you. You were not a normal person.
You're right.
Byron.
I do like
if this Byron. Were normal people, this podcast would not have started.
Bingo.
Then we're back to the wraparound. After the third segment, which is murderous animated garden gnomes, the final act in the wraparound, the goons are all back in the apartment in New York City again, even though all the videos were set in England. They are murdered by the puppet from the first movie, which was A, set in England, and B, a movie.
And there was no explanation for crossing that bridge?
And the puppet went into a trash compactor. Maybe it was a trash compactor
that spit them out into New York.
1983 New York.
Yeah, but Sam.
83 was a damn good year,
if
though.
Charles Lee Ray has taught me anything, dolls can put up with a lot. Chucky, Mr. Good Guy himself.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, I trust that this puppet might be...
A marriage to Jennifer Tilly.
And then look how that turned out.
Trash compactor.
Wait, who got married to Jennifer Tilly?
I mean, technically, Bride of Chucky.
Oh, right. Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah. Which has one of my favorite semi-truck murders. Remember that guy falls back into that semi-truck and it just kind of blows him up?
Nope.
It's a bad film.
Hey, no, guys. You guys are really trying to melt my brain before I can get all of my cryptid stuff out because...
Well, why don't we just jump right into it then?
Yeah, I really think we should.
Okay.
It's time
for... Oh, I'm not doing it. It's time for Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies.
Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies.
So this is a little sciencey, and I'm going to go ahead and admit up front, I am not a trained traditional scientist.
Oh, no. Hey, that's what they all say.
Big air quotes, a mainstream scientist rules of the scientific establishment.
I'm very interested in physics, obviously, but I, you know, took a couple physics classes. I do not have a physics degree, so I can't pretend to know all of the ins and outs of thermodynamics, etc. However, I'm going to do my best. I apologize for anything I get wrong. I welcome all input and corrections that any of our listeners might offer. But I'm going to talk tonight about Enrico Fermi.
No, stop it.
Can't I do it?
It's offensive.
No, I love the Italian.
Yeah.
Hey, Mario, it's me, Luigi.
Exactly.
That's what you're doing.
I know, but that's good.
I wouldn't say it's good.
Okay. Enrico Fermi was a Italian physicist, and he actually was the person who developed the first nuclear reactor. So the Fermi accelerator is at the Fermi labs. That's all the same Fermi. He's a BFD in the world of physics.
BFD. Oh, I get it.
Yeah, BFD. Like BFG. Hmm. Big friendly giant, but instead big fucking deal.
Okay, I get it.
He did a lot with nuclear physics, particle physics, statistical mechanics, quantum theory, and he is perhaps more infamously known as one of the fathers of the atomic bomb. One of the most interesting things that he discussed, though, is kind of a concept that had floated around, but had never been formulated so clearly, and it's known as the Fermi paradox. And the summary of this paradox is essentially rooted in the fact that there are roughly between 100 and 400 billion stars in our galaxy and about the same number of galaxies in the observable universe. So essentially, if we were to count every grain of sand on Earth, there would be 10,000 stars out there for each grain of sand that we know of. If there are this many stars and statistical probabilities about how many of those stars should be able to support life, where are all the aliens?
Okay.
Where is everyone?
Also, have you ever bought a star? If there's that many, this is a good business.
Okay, you can buy stars.
I know. Let's start selling stars.
No, but it's already being done.
Let's buy them in bulk and resell them.
That's smart, Sam.
So they've already been sold. Who gives a shit?
And we get the fuck out with the profits.
That's not cool.
It'll be tied up in the quartz for years.
I like the idea of naming stars.
You can name stars.
You can also name grains of sand.
You can.
I like the idea of having it like registered.
Things are free.
You guys are being mean. There is a Kardashev scale, which explains three different types of civilizations that scientists have identified. I think this is really interesting because it seems...
Courtney and Kim.
Shut up. You be nice to Chloe. I like Chloe. Here's an explanation of the Kardashev scale in the words of somebody that's certainly a little bit more eloquent than I.
A type 1 civilization would be able to access the whole energy available on its planet. In case you're wondering, we're currently around 0.73 on the scale, and we should reach type 1 sometime in the next couple of hundred years. Type 2 would be a civilization capable of harnessing all of the energy of its home star. This would require some serious science fiction, but it is doable in principle. Concepts like the Dyson Sphere, a giant complex surrounding the sun, would be conceivable. Type 3 is a civilization that basically controls its whole galaxy and its energy. An alien race this advanced would probably be godlike to us. But why should we be able to see such an alien civilization in the first place? If we were to build generation spaceships that could sustain a population for around 1,000 years, we could colonize the whole galaxy in 2 million years. Sounds like a long time, but remember, the Milky Way is huge. So if it takes a couple of million years to colonize the entire galaxy, then there are possibly millions, if not billions, of planets that sustain life in the Milky Way, and these other life forms have had considerably more time than we've had, then where are all the aliens? This is the Fermi Paradox.
So, Kelly, I'm going to stop reading.
What are you reading?
And just start practicing my British accent, because apparently all you need to sound smart...
Yeah.
Is a sweet British accent with piano played behind it.
It's very true. He's great.
He is great.
There are incredible theories out there. If you ask 10 different scientists, you're pretty much going to get at least 8 different answers about what the solution to this paradox might be. So we're going to talk through a few of them now.
Listen up, nerds.
I love nerds. Explanation group 1. So this group of scientists and individuals believes that there are no signs of higher civilizations because there are no higher civilizations in existence.
We're it.
Or at least type 1 is as far as it gets. Nobody gets past type 1. So there are a few different reasons to explain that. Some people would say that this group 1 is held back by something called the Great Filter. And the Great Filter theory basically... asserts that there is a self-checking limitation on how far life can advance. The stage that they can get to is this great filter, and once they get there...
they destroy themselves.
That's it. Exactly. If this theory is true...
We're talking about like the band filter breaking up?
Oh my God, no.
Okay.
if the theory of the grape filter is true,
Do you stop it. Remember them? Filter?
Yeah.
They were great.
Patrick from 99.
Do you know how much Fermi I have in my brain right now that's trying to get out?
Well, let's let it out.
Let my Fermi out.
Sure. No one's stopping you.
So, yeah, everybody's stopping me, actually.
You gotta back off. You gotta back off the mic.
So if this great filter theory is true, then the next question is obviously, okay, where the hell are we on the great filter timeline? Either A, we're incredibly rare and the great filter's behind us.
I can't stop thinking about that band.
Oh my God, stop it.
Hey man, nice
somehow
shot.
We've managed to get past this filter, which would mean we're incredibly rare for that. And that's why we haven't run into other types of intelligence, because almost nobody gets past it. The second option is that the great filter could be at the very beginning, and it may be actually incredibly unusual for life to begin at all. And that's why there really aren't that many civilizations out there. And so that's why we haven't had contact. And the other possibility is that we are actually coming up on the great filter. We're almost there. Therefore, the people who are as advanced as us in the other places in the universe also don't have the capacity to contact each other long distances. And so that's why. Who knows about this great filter idea? I am an optimist. I like to think that maybe we're capable of moving a little bit past that. So I'm hoping that we are not confined by the great filter.
This is that just song was literally about Bud Dwyer.
Yeah, it was.
Who's Bud Dwyer?
Oh my God, really?
Oh.
You don't know about Bud Dwyer? God, I want to start Byron's Serial Corner where I just cover horrific events.
Yeah, horrific events.
So Bud Dwyer was a senator?
No, he was like an ombudsman or an alderman, like smaller politician, local type.
He got caught in some sort of fraud.
Yeah, embezzlement or
And so he held a press conference at the beginning of the press conference.
Oh, and killed himself at
Jeez,
the press conference.
Jeez, you're blowing the... come on.
Sorry. For some reason, I was feeling like we were off air. I don't know why.
No, we're still rolling.
Go. Sorry.
No, but he handed out 3 manila envelopes. He said,
Don, there are some things for you to do. And it's a note in here for Joanne. Okay.
And then in another manila envelope, pulls out this pistol and shoots himself in the head. But he's like, I want everyone to step back. And kind of got like in a panic and then just did it. Live on the air, and there's 2 camera angles from local news.
See, this is the part that makes you creepy. The details you're about to give right now, that's what makes you creepy. Now go.
It was also featured on the First Faces of Death. I don't really need to go into detail.
Okay, and that, again, is what makes you creepy.
It's just one of those things you know. Everyone's seen this video.
No, it's not knowing about it. It's knowing about the camera angles and knowing that it was on Faces of Death because you watched
and
Faces
you've never
of Death.
Known.
I have searched multiple camera angles of the Bud Dwyer.
Okay, yeah. See, there you go.
So much blood.
It's a lot. I didn't want to say that because of this one over here. But
how does a head have that much blood in it?
Man, a very eye-opening experience. The first time I saw that, back away from the mic for me. The first time I saw I was very young. They were doing a screening of Faces of Death at the Carmack Cinema, and they actually handed out barf bags like the traditional, old school. Yeah,
they did a screening of Faces of Death at Carmack,
which is weird because they're a very Christian
company. So Jesus-y,
This was in high school. Didn't know brains had that much blood in them, for sure.
But, strange.
Hey, you guys mind if I keep talking about Fermi?
Science, okay.
You guys are fucking assholes. All I want to do is talk about
Fermi. We were talking about
head
science.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're moving past the great filter concept. We're on to another idea. And this is another solution that some scientists have come up with. This is that super intelligent life could very well have already visited us, but it was before we were here.
Reptilians.
Keep in mind, we haven't been around that long, you know? And when you look on the grand scale of things, we've actually only been looking for other life for 50 years.
Yeah, if you look at the grand scheme of things, that's just a blink.
I didn't say scheme.
I said it. What, are you making fun of me? You
making fun of me?
No, I'm not.
Okay. If we actually have been visited, there's a really decent chance that it happened before we knew what the hell was going on. Could be perhaps what we talked about in an earlier episode, a few episodes back, about the idea that Stonehenge and other great wonders of the ancient world might have to do with aliens. Perhaps that's when they visited, and that's why we aren't finding anybody now.
But why would they... humans were boring as shit back then.
Next possibility.
Oh no.
Next possibility.
Are we not going to discuss these each of the
There
fears?
Are like 10.
Okay, let's rock and roll.
Yeah, keep moving.
Next possibility is that the galaxy has actually been colonized, but we just live in like some shithole corner like Death Valley. Nobody wants to come visit us because the rest of the galaxy that's been colonized is just cooler than our part. And so everybody's like, oh Jesus, nobody wants to go there.
Why is there a theory that we'd be considered the shitty part?
The idea is that we live in a desolate rural area of the galaxy, possibly, because it could be that the civilizations that have colonized everywhere else, they have colonized areas that are better for their life form.
So we're in galactic Arkansas.
Yes, or Fargo or Death Valley. Yes, precisely.
If you live in Fargo, it's for sure not that bad. And I sang karaoke there once and it was great.
That didn't make it any better.
It was fine. They had Goo Goo Dolls.
I mean, for them.
Oh, you don't think my voice was a treat and a treasure?
Well, you know.
Come on now.
Next possibility. Completely ridiculous, and I tend to subscribe to theories like this. The concept of physical colonization is a totally backward concept to a more advanced species, and it's one of those things that we're really caught up in because of our limited intellectual capacity. But if one of these advanced, say, type 2 or type 3 civilizations were to hear about this idea of physical colonization, they'd be like, what are you talking about? Are you idiots? Why would we do that? In other words, there may be no desire to contact or colonize, and that's why we aren't hearing from any aliens. They may just be doing their own thing, and who gives a shit about those idiots over there? Okay?
Okay.
Sam, you're going to like this one. This is going to be your favorite theory by far. There is one or more than one scary predator civilization out there.
All right.
And possibly predators.
And most intelligent life knows better than to broadcast any outgoing signals because when they do, these predators attack. So we're the only idiots that are like flashing the neon sign. Hey, guys, we're over here.
No, we're the goat that they staked out in Jurassic Park for the Tyrannosaurus to come eat.
It very well could be. Very well could be. And in line with this theory, keep in mind that Stephen Hawking himself said, and I quote,
if aliens visit us, the outcome would be much as when Columbus landed in America, which didn't turn out very well for the Native Americans.
Interesting.
Even Carl Sagan, who, per the film based on his book, Contact, very much believed in friendly alien life, even he says that the idea of broadcasting ourselves out there is deeply unwise and immature. And recommended that the newest children in a strange and uncertain cosmos should listen quietly for a long time, patiently learning about the universe and comparing notes before shouting into an unknown jungle that we do not understand. And both of those are pretty interesting perspectives on that theory, I think. And Sam, like I said, I'm pretty sure that that's going to be your fave in this whole theory.
Well, yeah, that would make me the happiest.
Yeah. Along with that possibility, it isn't just that people out there are trying not to broadcast themselves, but this super predator civilization actually comes and exterminates any life form that gets to a certain point. So any other life form that would be advanced enough to communicate with us has been exterminated.
But it's so big.
It is big. But I mean, keep in mind, if we're talking about one of those type 2 or type 3 civilizations that the brilliant that British man explained for us, they're godlike. Like they do things that we can't even comprehend. The idea of them being able to jump around and exterminate everything in the universe, totally doable.
Yeah.
I'm actually going to get to, you know, I'm going to skip ahead to a theory that's going to kind of touch on what you said there. And this is the theory that higher civilizations are here all around us, but we're too primitive to perceive them. Michio Kaku, a renowned physicist, actually has a great quote about this. And I think it's in line with what you were just saying, Byron. Let's say we have an anthill in the middle of a forest. Right next to the anthill, they're building a 10-lane superhighway. And the question is, would the ants be able to understand what a 10-lane superhighway is? Would the ants be able to understand the technology and the intentions of beings building the highway next to them? Obviously not.
No.
And truthfully, the difference between a type 1 and a type 2 or a type 1 and a type 3 civilization is even bigger than that. So there are things that are way beyond our comprehension. So I don't think that that's unreasonable to look at from that perspective. Although I am not one to subscribe to this idea that a life form that advanced would have any reason to be a predator-style life form.
Instead, they'd be like the people in Interstellar.
Exactly. That's why I love Interstellar.
They would have video games that would be so much fun that they literally could not tear themselves away for long enough to go exterminate other races.
I think that the British guy actually... Yeah.
Yes.
I think the British guy actually talked about that in the lengthier definition of civilizations of type 3. Yeah, I think it had something to do with really great video games. You're an idiot, sweetheart. I love you. Okay. A couple other theories. Obviously, this is one that we get into quite a bit with some of Kelly's cryptids and conspiracies. We are receiving contact from other intelligent life, but the government's hiding it. Most scientists would discount this. Some scientists think it's true. I am certainly not going to say that that's absolutely true, but there's some really fun theories that are worth reading out there about how that may or may not be the case. Like treaties being signed by a president.
How can we never talk about that?
Yeah, we do. We talk about that all the time.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
It's just that no one's listening.
Oh. Yeah.
All that stuff gets erased from the tapes.
So there may be activity.
I'm the government.
I know. There may be activity and noise out there, but our technology isn't advanced yet to listen to it or to pick it up because we're listening for the wrong things.
Well, wait, we tend to focus on things like radio waves.
Right. Which, exactly, Brian. And I think that's an issue because to me, if we're thinking in outside the box terms of what kind of communication devices a more advanced civilization might be using, it seems like a really weird thing to gravitate to and to latch onto. And it could just be because that's all we've got right now.
It's even
to be able
primitive
to broadcast.
Now, though.
Like, right, exactly. Part of the hope organizations like SETI is that if these civilizations have advanced, they've advanced through stages similar to what we've advanced through so that they might be using more primitive forms to contact. But then I look at it like, why the hell would they want to contact us? What are they going to get out of a contact with us?
I think we just need to focus on using more advanced ways of communication, like meditation and positive thinking.
Okay, so I actually like meditation and positive thinking.
But it's bullshit.
Well, though. The whole idea of energy
Western Union Telegram.
No, that's not true. The whole idea of energy is actually becoming much less of a New Age thing and much more of a physics and science thing.
I know there's science to it, but I'm just saying that like in that documentary Sirius that I know we both watched, how they're trying to call down UFOs with meditation and focused thought. I don't think...
Without crystals, it's a lot of wasted effort.
Well, that's what I've been forgetting is the crystals.
Okay, so I'm not going to mock people for that because I don't know.
I gotta go, guys.
That could be really good. Okay, you guys, my last theory.
Oh, okay.
Because this is what you were talking about.
Come on, Byron.
This is another fun one that Sam will like, but it kind of is what you were just saying too, Byron. Higher civilizations know that we're here. They're watching us, but we're like the zoo.
Sure.
So they're basically just watching us and saying, oh, God, stay away from them. Really fun, really entertaining. Don't touch.
They throw poop at the windows.
So, and actually, there's in one of the descriptions of this theory, Byron, there's a reference to Star Trek.
I don't watch Star Trek.
They're hypothesizing that there's a rule similar to the Star Trek's Prime Directive, which basically prohibits any very intelligent beings from making open contact with far less intelligent beings like us. Or revealing themselves in any way until those lower life forms get to a certain point in their evolutionary process, because otherwise it can throw things off wildly. But I think that there are some interesting bits of evidence around for some of these more advanced civilizations contacting us. What I like is the final theory that basically says we're totally wrong about everything. The way that we perceive our own reality is just totally off. Maybe we're the aliens. Maybe we're here and we're as some form, you know, like we could be fertilizer. We could be some kind of an experiment. We could be a computer simulation. You know, obviously the Matrix theory.
I prefer surrogate.
Okay.
The surrogate theory.
The surrogate theory.
Starring Bruce Willis.
Yeah. Okay. We could be a total hologram and our very existence could be a complete fabrication.
Why did Neo try to break out of that? It seemed like it was a lot.
Life was pretty good.
Pretty all right.
Because freedom
nutrients.
Is everything and there was no freedom in that, Byron.
Yeah, but you still have to pull a tube out of your throat.
Yeah.
It's not fun.
Once he knew that he wasn't free, he couldn't do anything but fight for it.
Yeah, he could have taken the other pill.
Well, but that was before he really knew what was going on.
Frightday is really doing our part to prove that humanity is worthy of contact.
Yeah. So that's Fermi. All of those theories are worthy of their own in-depth discussion, but I just wanted to throw kind of a big wide range out there to let everybody know that I really do investigate things from different angles, and I think that all of those different approaches are fascinating, whether you listen to Carl Sagan's old videos talking about them or you listen to Bill Nye talk about his solution to the Fermi paradox.
That guy's done a really great job of rebranding himself, by the way.
Bill Nye?
Yeah,
the problem is he's kind of rebranded himself into an asshole.
Liquid, solid, and gas? You can't call that man an asshole.
Well, I just mean that he's very confrontational about any anybody who happens to present an opinion different from his. It's almost like he's getting to be a crotchety old man, but in like a science sense.
He has a jingle.
He's just
it's his name.
It's true.
It's Bill Nye, the science guy.
Well,
Bill.
That's Bill, not part Bill. Of, just to be clear, that's part of the old brand, not the new brand.
I understand.
How many jingles has Kel? No, fuck. Never mind. I didn't say it.
Hey, Byron, we need a hardcore jingle for Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies.
Someday.
Sorry, Byron.
Can I write a jingle? I used to write music. Can I please write a jingle?
Absolutely not.
What if I have one of my colleagues write a jingle for me?
Colleagues? Or are we doing an open call to the Academy?
Oh my God. If somebody from the Academy submitted a jingle for Captain Kelly's segment. Oh,
I like how your only qualification was a jingle.
Yeah, just open jingle. Just...
Unlike Bill Nye, I am open-minded and I like different perspectives and different forms of art. I would love to hear anybody's interpretation of what a Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies jingle should sound like.
You have to be nice. He taught me the states of matter and that's about it.
Well, I would hope that a few teachers along the way also contributed to that bit of knowledge.
Mostly
Byron,
just Bill Nye and a little bit of Schoolhouse Rocks.
And I just feel like Neil deGrasse Tyson is a much better scientist because he doesn't come off like a closed-minded jerk. And Bill Nye, in some of his interviews with people that are investigating some of these fringe things, he's just a jerk.
I don't know.
He's dismissive and rude and not scientific or logical. Mm-hmm. He's just rude.
And this has been Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracies this week. You taught us a lot about aliens. Overall, do you believe that we've been contacted?
I do.
Okay.
I do.
So
I feel like there's too much out there. You can absolutely write some of them off. You can probably write a good portion of them off, but you can't write all of them off. Honestly, the only two feasible explanations that I've come across is either A, we absolutely have been contacted, or B, there is a legitimate psychological disorder that is specifically designed in the way that makes people think that they've been contacted.
What was the last part?
Well, it could be that that's, you know, a mental health issue. There's something that goes weird in our brain and that's the experience that we believe we're having. There are way too many people out there that I think are absolutely convinced that this has happened to them and it's not just crazy weird out there individuals or people who've done a shitload of drugs or people who've been in really traumatic situations, but it's also just run-of-the-mill average Joes. There are just too many to write it off. I don't know what it is or where they're from or what the purpose is, but I really do think we have been contacted.
And someday they're going to come and put our skulls on a ship like a predator.
Well, actually, Byron, have I ever told you the story about the scar on my leg? This is kind of an interesting story.
No. Do we have time for this? Is this good for another time?
Well, it's only like a minute long story. So when I was a little kid, 5-6 years old, I went to the doctor, normal checkup. My mom was in there with me. And the doctor was asking a bunch of questions. And it was like a new pediatrician, I think, that I had. There's a scar on the back of my leg. And the doctor's like, oh, you didn't tell me in her medical history that she'd had surgery. And my mom's like, she hasn't. She's never had surgery. And he's like, that is absolutely a surgical scar on the back of her leg. And my mom's like, it's not and it can't be. She's never had surgery. And he's like, it's a surgical scar. She has a surgical scar on the back of her leg. And just to back this up, I actually very truthfully had dreams, rephrasing that, nightmares, every single night for like a 3 or 4 year period where I saw that creepy gray face at the window of my bedroom. Now, granted, I did walk in on my parents watching Fire in the Sky somewhere around this time. I'm just saying the weird scar was not something that I manifested. It's still there today. It creeps me the hell out. There you go.
I have a theory about that scar.
What's your theory?
You were home alone with your dad and he wasn't paying attention. You fell off of something into something and cut the shit out of yourself.
It wouldn't look like a surgical scar.
He performed some stitching at home and didn't tell your mom about it.
Honey, my dad would not do that. My dad would freak out. He'd have a panic attack. He'd be like Byron.
Yeah.
He would like melt and he'd like curl up into a ball in the corner until my mom came home.
And we all know that Fire in the Sky was made in cooperation of Greys as a propaganda film to not only bring their presence to the forefront, but also to make people not believe in it. So
I think it was the dolphins. Yeah,
I don't know that I believe in those, you know, like reverse psychology theories. But I mean, who knows? Who knows? There's a lot of interesting stuff out there. You bet.
You bet.
You bet. You bet. You bet. Thanks, everybody.
Do you know what I bet? I bet people want to hear us talk about a horror movie.
Probably.
At this point
in
the show.
Isn't that what we do?
Yeah, I think so. Let's talk about a movie about a sexually transmitted plague called Contracted, Phase 2.
enjoying your visit here this evening. Now, on with the show.
Contracted Phase 2 is a 2015 American horror sequel directed by Josh Forbes. Sam, would you like to tell us what this film is all about?
It's spreading. After Contracted unleashed the world's most horrifying virus, this sequel picks up the story as newly infected Riley races against time to contain the outbreak even as it ravages his own body. As he digs deeper into his origins, Riley attracts the attention of a detective who doubts his innocence, and BJ himself, who holds the key to the virus, and perhaps the destruction of mankind as we know it, leading to a blood-soaked finale you'll have to see to believe. Hang on to your barf bags, buckle up, and get ready for the genre ride of the year. That's from the official.
Yeah, let's not be so dramatic. We're talking about a sequel.
Yeah, come on, guys. I'm going to start with what I think this movie did very well.
That's a nice place.
The body horror and the effects were done extremely well. Groan-inducing outright, maybe a little stomach-turning for the horror neophyte.
So the movie takes place immediately following the end of Contracted.
Yeah, literally the first couple minutes of Phase 2 are the last couple minutes.
I liked that.
The first one.
I thought that was cool. I liked the seamless transition.
I very much enjoyed it as well, but they kind of resolved that transition too fast for me.
We switched to the new character and the new sequence of events just very rapidly.
Yeah, when you bill your movie as picking up immediately following the events of the initial film, I just kind of expected them to carry on for a little bit more or continue on in that direction. Movies are more successful if they follow that three-act structure, and it's hard to jump right into the tail end of such
act
a...
three.
Yeah, such
and
a...
start act one.
But I kind of felt a bit misled at the beginning of this movie, and it gave a bad taste in my mouth.
They hit the hard reset button 3 minutes into the movie.
However, one of the things early on in the movie that I thought was pretty damn good, the guy's sitting in a doctor's office, it turns out to be just his brother-in-law, and he's trying to pull something out of his back, and we know that happened in the first movie.
Mm-hmm. We're talking about Riley's character.
And Riley pulls this fingernail out of his back. That, like, there were a couple things like that I thought were super creepy and super gross.
Well, fingernails are disgusting.
Well, they are.
And all of those types of things were what made the original film so successful.
Yeah. The squeamishness.
I don't know what was missing in those scenes, but for some reason I felt like all of the charm of the original was gone. I don't know if the sound design was different because I know that was a high point when we discussed the original film in association with all of these pretty uniquely vile situations was a pretty great accompanied sound zoom.
I think you're right. The visuals were there, but each instance of those effects, it was more like a set piece. Separate vignettes that were connected pretty loosely by some weak plot. I just wanted to see what next pus-dripping, bloody, oozing excrescence was gonna happen next, and I kind of had to make it through everything that happened in between.
Yeah, it's hard for me because you guys know that it takes a very special zombie / plague film to really sucker me in. Honestly, the last one that did so completely for me was 28 Weeks Later.
I knew it was coming.
I honestly, it's on my top list when it comes to horror movies. This, I thought, had some good moments in it. And believe it or not, I thought the acting was not nearly as bad as I might have expected from, you know, this type of a genre, this type of a sequel, etc. I actually thought it was decent. But the way that the story unfolded just was a little bit less than satisfying for me.
A lot of people have been comparing this movie to the 28 Days, 28 Weeks
which
evolution.
Which is crazy to me.
Yeah, and I don't think it ever did kind of reach that massive spread. Spoiler alert, I guess. It's not much of a spoiler alert. We don't hit that massive
pandemic state.
Yeah. Personally, to me, I would compare this to the sequel of Quarantine. It's a little bit better in quality, but the tone is off in that same kind of way. They had a hit and they're almost trying to replicate that feeling.
For me, it didn't have the urgency. You were there with Samantha and Contracted as the symptoms manifested. That sinking feeling that you know your life is never going to be the same. Even if you can figure out a way to stop it, you're totally f***ed. I just didn't have that as we watched Riley decay. It was kind of like, well, that's interesting, I guess. What's he doing now?
You know what I think is missing is the fact that when you watch the original you don't know that she's necessarily turning into a zombie. You don't know the end result. But in this, you know
it's out of the bag.
You know exactly what's going on, even though it was kind of obvious, the situation in the original. And I hope that people would watch the original. What are you pointing at?
I need a cord.
A cord? Oh, a power cord. You're scaring me.
Yeah, Jesus.
Folks, thank you.
Once you know the situation, it's just going through the motions. And they do in the third act kind of pick up. And that's where my hopes are kind of lifted. I was nervous that they were going to go in some sort of cheesy way, but they go full embracing.
Walrus?
I guess full walrus. They embrace the situation. Our main character, Riley, decides that even though he's infected, he's going to try to fight BJ. In the first movie, played by Simon Barrett, in this movie, recast by someone that almost gives me these weird kind of B-movie feels, but in a fun way. That's when the movie turned fun for me. The third act, I found myself going, oh, this is just a weird movie, as opposed to this kind of serious tone of the original.
Which you almost have to do when you know it's going to be a zombie movie going into it. There are only so many different ways that can be rehashed. And all you can hope for, I think, is great effects, do the transformation as well as possible. You know, hope for a few jump scares and maybe some turned stomachs.
Remember when that girl comes in who was a former drug addict and starts scratching her skin?
Oh, so gross.
There is this moment of real crazy body horror decomposition, and it was done really well. There were some moments of like skin digging and comedy at this point that worked hand in hand to make it actually pretty enjoyable.
One thing that was also very different, and I guess it didn't detract too much from the movie, but it speaks to that change in tone, that change in overall feel. The first movie had sexual overtones. That was like the pervasive theme of the movie, was this terror is spread by sexual contact. And it was, you know, kind of a statement on sexuality, and that it didn't play more than a origins role. There wasn't the sexual tension.
No, one person is infected by a kiss in this.
Yeah.
Yeah, they don't have that sort of lust element at all.
Yeah, because, I mean, it's universal. It speaks to a universal human drive.
Oh, and back to that arm-grabbing scene. Do you remember what the security guard said?
I believe, wasn't it, oh, hell no?
Exactly. Oh, hell no. I wrote that down.
Just turned around and ran, left him there to deal with the necrotic drug addict?
Yeah, and there's a couple of moments like that, where one guy approaches Riley and said, this is gonna get ugly, bro. And he says, I'm already ugly. And like takes off his sunglasses and he's got
those in the rotten eyes.
It tonally is a completely different thing. But when they fully embrace that, that's when I really connected with this movie. The eye scene, are you popping your eye over there?
Oh.
So aside from the first act pacing problems, I found myself actually kind of enjoying this. I don't know if it would work better if I hadn't seen the original.
I think it might have.
The original set high expectations.
And the original is also very polarizing. I've heard people who hate the original.
Well, they're wrong.
They are pretty wrong, in my opinion. But these are two completely different movies. And I'm actually very impressed with the director. I don't know how much crap he's going to get for it. But I think he did a good job with what he had. This is how it kind of works. They have to pay their dues with these sequels that are handed to them. But I think he's going to do some cool stuff.
Yeah, and you were looking up some of his previous work.
Yeah, he's done some huge, huge stuff. He did that Sarah Bareilles, I'm not going to write you a love song, but not as rock and roll as that was.
Yeah, I know.
Because you asked for it.
And You Found Me by The Fray, as well as that song by Walk the Moon, Shut Up and Dance, which was really big all summer.
Some serious hits.
It's kind of amazing that he's just now getting into these features. And I was listening to an interview with him. He loves genre films, so I couldn't be more happy for what he's doing. Also, he was nominated for a VMA this year. I don't know if you know what those are. It's something the kids do.
Yeah, the youth.
On MTV, which is a website, but it's also on TV. Which is weird, right?
What does that even stand for?
I'm not exactly sure, but he was nominated for a VMA, and apparently MTV doesn't give people who are nominated free seats to the event.
That is such bullshit.
It's insane. I don't get it. Apparently the tickets are between like $500 and $1,500 to get a seat.
Which is...
And they let Kanye in for free, I would imagine, right? Because he just is basically a host at this point.
He's going to end up on stage saying stupid shit.
He did some sort of GoFundMe page to get money to go to the VMAs, which I think was a very cool thing for him to do. And he got a suit donated to him by some other company.
Which I think is an important statement about, oh, you make movies. You must be rich and famous and living the life of celebrity.
Yeah, it's not like that. Music video directors, especially in the age of YouTube, I don't think they necessarily get the money or the attention that they deserve. I can't wait to see what this guy does next. Hopefully it's not some sort of cheap sequel. Excuse me, I threw up. I'm real tired.
I know.
We've said a lot of things regarding the fact that it is a pretty rapidly pushed out sequel with some tone issues. But if you ignore all that, it's actually a pretty fun movie. It's gory. It had a pretty wicked nosebleed scene that rivals some stuff I've seen in Drag Me to Hell. And for that reason, I'm going to give it a 5.2. It'll definitely be worth it when it's on Netflix instant. I have a feeling this is going to be kind of a smash on Netflix.
Overall, I had fun with this movie. There were spots that were a little bit rough and some things that I think you really could tell that this was a rushed production. It had a pretty generic industrial score, which didn't do it for me. Tons of really awesome special effects. The acting was good for what was called for. And I'm with you about hoping to see more from Josh Forbes soon. And I'm going to give this, I'm going to give it a 5.0.
So I...
Did Kelly say much this episode?
Well, to be honest...
You said a lot during the beginning of the episode. I don't know.
I talked a lot.
Yeah.
Well, I just feel bad because this one is both not in my wheelhouse and then also just didn't really connect with me. I don't quite subscribe to the...
Going to get a bottom score from Kelly?
Yeah, you're going to.
We are.
This is great.
I don't quite subscribe to the if you don't have something nice to say, don't say anything at all, but I'm trying to lean that direction because I don't want to be an ass because... I think that we have listeners who would really enjoy this movie, and it's just not my gig. I thought there were a couple fun points, and the scene you described with the drug addict clawing her arms off was really gross. The fingernail thing in the back was gross, but to me, it felt like it never really went anywhere dramatic. It never really moved beyond where I felt the last movie ended. And it just felt kind of recycled and that we were kind of circling the drain for whatever hour and 18 minutes.
Yeah, very short film.
Yeah. So I thought the practical effects were really good and the acting was better than it needed to be. I give it a 4.2.
Boom.
That's a first.
I love it. Oh, it finally happened.
Sorry, guys.
And the honor goes to Contracted Phase 2.
Lowest Kelly score of the year.
Oh, that's not true.
Well, that's true. No,
the only movie that Kelly has ever rated lower than both Byron and I.
Is that true?
Oh, absolutely.
I'm sure it is. Let us know what you thought about this movie. We'd love to hear what you have to say. And also, if you have a favorite plague, disease, pestilence, pandemic movie, let us know about it.
Tweet us at Frightday on Twitter.
But more importantly, if any of you have been abducted by aliens, tweet that to me so that I can contribute it to my theories on the Fermi Paradox.
Are we both losing it? I only talk about serial killers, and now you think you have a legitimate alien scar on your leg.
It's not now. I've thought that for 20 years. What has happened
when Sam is the normal one?
Oh, God, Sam.
In the land of the blind, the one...
Be a normal person. Go on iTunes and write us a nice little review. Click some stars and subscribe. And make sure to grab your friend's phone and subscribe to our podcast. That would be really, really extremely cool of you. And you know what would be cooler, Kelly?
What?
I think you do know, right?
Well, if you guys want to look cooler, you can always purchase a Captain Kelly's Cryptids and Conspiracy shirt.
Or any shirt at shop.frightday.com.
You can. And honestly, all of them are great. It's just that the Captain Kelly one is obviously a little bit better.
Heads up, guys. Anyone out there with a Hairwolf pin? Those are now officially sold out.
They're collector's items, people.
So throw them up on eBay, make a bajillion dollars, or just make bootleg ones, right? You could easily just
don't encourage that.
I mean, it'd be kind of fun. Just, I don't really care. You
just
Byron, knock that shit off.
Slap them face down on the copier. Run a couple of them off, cut it out, glue it on to some other shitty podcast, small pins, nice. And you got yourself a hair wolf.
Kelly, yo, it's getting late.
Sure is.
But it's never too late to talk to a ghost. EVP, or electronic voice phenomenon, is a common practice within the field of parapsychology and on this podcast, right, Kelly?
Nope.
It's used to capture answers and concerns of residual spirits.
Messing with shit you shouldn't be messing with,
like
Ron.
Like one that might be in the room with us right now. I know that we've been coming up with questions. If you have a question for a ghost, you can definitely tweet us at Frightday. That would be great. But Sam, do you want to know if we're alone in the universe? Do you think a ghost would know more than a human?
Let's see if Enrico Fermi's ghost is here and ask him.
I mean, or just some of the
Fermi.
What the fuck ever?
Sure, Enrico Fermi.
I don't know why he would be here.
Yeah, I don't know either. But maybe someone knows him in the ghost world.
Somebody want to run out of Frightday Studios and see if there are any ghosts down there? Like ghost. An intern or somebody?
Hey, someone.
Our intern's asleep.
If there is a ghost in this house and you want to say something, let's step up to the plate. If you know more than us about this topic, please speak up. Are we alone in the universe? As always, thank you so much for your time. We very much appreciate your cooperation and your role in the show. You're one of us, part of the Boo crew.
I appreciate you being polite.
One of us.
Of course I'm going to be polite to a ghost.
One of us.
Remember last time I got lippy with the Warrens?
Yeah, that was not cool.
Very scary moment for me.
Yeah, it was actually a very scary moment for me, too.
Oh, God, that was intense.
Or off the wall.
It's time for sleepy sleep.
Super yes.
Where can we find you on the internet?
I'm tweeting at Sam Frightday. Reach me by email, sam@frightday.com.
At Kelly Frightday on Twitter and kelly@frightday.com. By email, and as always, love hearing from you guys.
Still collecting ghost stories, huh?
Yeah, we've been cultivating some great stories over the last few months. We've got some awesome listeners with some pretty terrifyingly incredible experiences.
And I'm at Byron McKoy on Twitter. Byron@frightday.com is my email address, and my serial killer of the week is a classic. Jeffrey Dahmer, the Milwaukee cannibal himself. If you don't know Jeffrey Dahmer, I don't want to know you, but I do. It's so great to hear from you guys. The response makes this all worth it.
100%.
All the sleepless nights, the ghouls we have to talk to.
The ghouls I have to sleep in the same house as. Not even talking about Sam there.
And until next Frightday, I'm Byron.
I'm Kelly.
And I'm Sam.
Stay safe. Sexually.